Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast, presented by Lup. Fuck. Good start. This is the
Great start.
Always a great start. I'm not going to cut that because, this is real. This is a real podcast. Welcome to the SWN Podcast. Excellent. Take two. Welcome to the SWN Podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. This is presented by Manscaped. Hopefully, I don't know. I still haven't got my Manscaped kit to give you the full rundown. My testicles are still firmly hairy, so you all need to know that. I am joined by a returning guest for the first time since January 2021 was the last time we had an episode out with this man. He's went on to star on the WWE Network. He's went on to be on absolute national television, primetime national television. It is the one and only the Asian Sensation TV's Umar Mohammed. Welcome back.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So you need to put in a bit of applause there. You know, just like calm that in. Calm laughter. Calm the pause.
You know what? I will do that for you.
Thank you.
Figure out how I will do that for you. If anyone's seen my editing, that is big. although to be honest, I've started doing end credits and little bits for episodes. So I mean, it's not impossible.
Expand your horizons.
No, I did the Lightning McQueen one for you.
Oh, that was amazing. Genuinely.
And the Where's Wally one was a little bit of a favourite for me.
Got a Lane McQueen there, don't know if you can see.
Ka-chow. Well, we'll start with that then. What is it with Lightning McQueen and Cars in general? Why?
Cars is just my favourite movie. It genuinely is my favourite movie. I want to say it's either the first movie I saw at the cinema, or it was like the one that I remember, like the first one that I can remember seeing at the cinema. And what I gathered as well is, I didn't realize this until last year, the actual premiere of Cars came out and was like, the premiere of Cars was on my birthday.
Ah, meant to be then.
Like, yeah.
It's meant to be. I went to see Cars in the cinema as well. I think it was down at Darlington. I went to go see it because I was visiting family, and we're like, "What? Well, nothing's on. We'll see this film." And then it was Cars. So
I think it was Halloween Hijinks, I'm sure. And like Aspen had came up to me and just went, "What's your obsession with Cars?" And I was like, "It's just my favorite movie." Just so confused.
I'm glad you just didn't get defensive and just go, "Well, what's your obsession with pigtails?"
the weird headband thing.
Yeah, it doesn't hold up your hair. No. So Cars. I'm glad that I got to see you, the happiness on your face when you got to ride like the McQueen at the Trinity Center.
I saw that was there, I said to Tommy Raiden, I said, we have to get a photo. And I couldn't get a photo at any point until making my entrance for the Battle Royal.
I know, we'd guarded it because we'd picked a wee corner so we didn't have to actually, so I could see mainly. Kelly wasn't that fussed for seeing it too much. She's seen enough wrestling that day. She was like, fine, you just stay. I was like, I kept telling her, one more match. And then there was always another match afterwards. I was like, it's fine, this will be the last one.
How many matches that day?
I know, and I missed the first couple, but I got to see your tag team match, you and, I guess it was you and Tommy against Murphy and Dino, probably.
Murphy and Dino.
Got to see that from the nice view from the Flying Tiger that was down there. Picking out sweets and all that kind of stuff and just seeing you guys batter each other in the distance. It was a nice little corner. I didn't know what to expect. When I knew this wrestling was going to be on at the Trinity Center, I was like, all right, hopefully there's chairs. There was no chairs.
No chairs. You just had to stand. Yeah, stand room only.
Exactly, yeah. Everyone got a standing ovation as soon as they came out, and I had to try and roam around, try to get pictures and avoid people, really. That's why I use it as the excuse. Oh, I'm taking pictures. Go away. Leave me alone. Leave me alone now. Anyway, right. So, my note-taking didn't really go well because you are one of the only people in Scotland that still does not have a cage match profile.
I don't, and it really bothers me. I don't know why. I see every other guy got a cage match profile. And I'm thinking, I just want one. Just want one to say that I've got one. I don't.
Caleb doesn't have one either, which I'm surprised by.
That also surprises me. The guy's been everywhere.
Bloody Germans. they're quite happy to steal my results, but they're not happy enough to actually make profiles for these people. I tried to get an account for a cage match, and you have to like do 10 reviews before you can actually edit anything. I'm like, can't be arsed to do that. Just let me add people. I can do all the stats. I've got them all. I can make some up if you want. Anyway, right. Let's go to the fun. This is the most unstructured episode of the podcast that will ever be, because usually I would start with like, oh, what you been up to? But it's one of those weird ones where I've seen what you've been up to. So
you've seen what I've been up to.
Yeah. But yeah, what have you been up to then? So it's been 2 years. January 2021 was our last episode. You've expanded your horizons. You've come up north. You've come here to stay. What's been happening?
What has been happening? Oh God. I mean, yeah, like 2021, still around the time of like the pandemic. So it was like the promotions hadn't started yet. And then all of a sudden, like as soon as it got to like May 2021, just like all the promotions came back, and then I just got bookings. Don't know what happened, but yeah. I came to Aberdeen for university, and then rest of them were like, you're in Aberdeen, what up? Now I'm here. I don't know how long until, because my uni, I've almost finished uni. Dissertation is killing me. So anyone who's doing a dissertation or has done a dissertation, I can relate. So yeah.
I like the thought of Big William Starling just typing what up. That just tickled me.
Yeah.
So of course, yeah, you came back. October 2021 was your re-debut for WrestleZone after your match with Caleb at Proving Grounds 2019, something like that. And folk loved you. They remembered you, or they were just all into the Asian sensation, even though you're teaming with Ted O'Keefe, who we don't really mention nowadays for whatever reason. But yeah, so you came back. Everyone loved you. Of course, I'm a big nerd for all the Scottish wrestling stuff, so I know what's going on generally. If you come out, I'll know a little bit about you, or I've seen something. But I gauge all my reaction really through Kelly, because she doesn't know. She just comes to the shows, enjoys them, and that's it. And you were one of our favorites coming out of the shows. I really like that Umar Mohammed. Well, I like the guy who did the dancing was the first thing, and I went, Umar, yes, Umar Mohammed. So yeah, what was it like getting that reaction, that first show back? Everyone was pumped for some wrestling. You were coming out, I think, one of the first matches. And yeah, what was it like?
It was definitely a weird one. Like in terms of the overall, how the match came about, and then the actual like match itself. So like I just came to Aberdeen, and then I got a message from Aspen. And he like does the graphic designs for WrestleZone. So he messaged me and went, hey, have you got like any updated promo photos? I'm thinking, yeah, like here, I'll send some along. I'm thinking, well, I'm not booked on any shows that you really do the graphics for, unless, and he's like, don't tell anyone, but you're on Halloween Hijinks. And I thought, well, the card's already booked. And then Connor Malloy, he messages me and goes, yeah, I think you're in our tag match. I'm like, well, I've not been told anything. And then I get a message from like WrestleZone being like, yeah, you're wrestling in the tag match. And I'm thinking, all right, cool. Me and Ted, the unlikely duo. And yeah, like the response that I got, like even now making my entrance and I'm getting the reactions that I am, I've said to like Caleb and that, I don't understand why people like it so much, because it's just me.
That's it. They I mean, I think the fans at WrestleZone especially, they see, if you're pretending to play a character, they'll see it through it quite easily, and they'll still react yeah boo, but they won't take you in, kind of thing. They'll just like, ah, cool, yeah, clap, yay. But if they see you're actually enjoying yourself and being genuine and actually interacting with people, they'll properly go, This is our guy now. This is we've claimed Umar.
It's like even since like the Proving Ground match, like when it came out there, that was like the first time I'd worked base anywhere. So like I'd like worked heel, like W3L and that. So then when it came to like WrestleZone, you're like, oh yeah, you're a face. I'm thinking, right, okay, like, don't exactly know what I'm doing. So I came out, and then when I came back, Scott, Swift and I were like, yeah, you're like, you're a face. So then even now, it's just the case of, yeah, you're a face for like, the crowd love you. I'm like, well, fair enough. The crowd wants what the crowd wants.
That's it. They'll tell you if they like you or not, and it's worked for a lot of people. I mean, of course, Caleb came in as apparently he was a bad guy, but I never. He's too pretty, to be honest, to be a bad guy. That was kind of the thing for him.
Stupid sexy Caleb, honestly.
Stupid sexy Caleb. Yeah. This is not a Caleb Valhalla podcast. Much pay. Right. Anyways.
Valhalla podcast.
I just make the half an hour just going, isn't he just beautiful? I think.
Wow.
Godlike.
Him with hair, him without hair, just he can pull off all looks.
He can do it all. He's just the greatest. Anyway, back to Umar Mohammed. I spent most of my time now at shows not just enjoying it, but I'm under my breath correcting people, which I don't know why it's become a personal trait of mine. But every time someone shouts next to me, going, "Come on, Umar, please." I got this wrong back in 2020. I need to correct people now. Everyone needs to know it's still Umar. Are you just happy just to get a reaction, though? You're not fussed if what people call you?
It's at the point now where not fussed. Umar, I don't mind. It was like past week there at Ellen, and the crowd were like, "Come on, Umar." And then even like Alan Sterling was like, "Come on, Umar." Like, I'm just like, God, my name's Umar. It's Umar, but I'm pretty sure it's in the Quran that's spelled with a U for like Umar. So I can't really be like, "Mom, Dad, why did you spell me with a U instead of an O? Don't you realize this problem that's been caused?" But.
Well, keep it on the back pocket for if we ever need to chastise anyone up in the Northeast. You've got that. You've got that there. You can just shout at them, say your name right, you know? Just,
yeah.
Got that there. Speaking of your mom and dad then, let's just get into family fortunes. That seems okay. Like a good way to go with it. Segues are wonderful. Right, okay. So you did Family Fortunes. I was super excited to find out. I don't generally watch Family Fortunes. I think you may have told me to watch Family Fortunes that particular week. And I was like, all right, okay. And then I saw the blurb going, the Mohammed family. I was like, ah, right. We've got this now. I know what's happening. How did that come about?
So the actual episode was filmed in 2020. So it was filmed in November 2020. So it was about 2 years since it had been filmed that it got like released. So I've been trying to keep this a secret for as long as I can. To be honest, like half the time now, like it got to the point like last year where if like someone mentioned something, I'd be like, yeah, it was on Family Fortunes. Like I wasn't even at the point where I'm like, I'm not even going to hide it anymore because I didn't even know if it was going to get actually released. Because like they said to us, like it got filmed in November 2020, and they went, oh yeah, it's going to be released in like March 2021. Then it was like, oh no, September 2021. And then it was just, yeah, we don't know. And then like my mate, she messaged me, like, well, literally I was at the gym and she messaged me with like a Snapchat being like, what's happening on like the day that it was getting released? I was like, okay, we didn't get any notification or anything. I guess it's just releasing in like 2 weeks. But like the application process was surprisingly easy for what it is. I think we were watching Catchphrase. Like me and my family were watching Catchphrase. And then my dad was like, maybe we should try and go on a show. Because I think we got some answers right on Catchphrase for some reason. Like we had this confidence of wanting to be on a game show. So my sister then looked online and like found like game show like applicants, like the application process, and Family Fortunes were looking for families, and they mentioned that I was a wrestler. They mentioned I, th- I don't even know what it was about my sister. I think she, like, that she does like painting, even though she's a horrendous painter. Honestly, she's such a bad painter. She used to be good. She's bad now. She hasn't done it in a while. So for some reason, she said that. And then they were like, oh yeah, like Omar's a wrestler. Yeah, okay, like we're putting this family on. And then it was a case of, right, this is during lockdown. I've not been at the gym. What's happening? And then like within like 3 weeks, they came to like the house and filmed that like 5 minute thing that you see at the start. Then they were asking for photos and videos, so I had to sort that out. And then within like the next week, we were flying down to, I can't remember where it was. I want to say it was like Leeds or somewhere. We flew down to Leeds to like film it. And then that was it. Literally just got our money and just got sent back to Scotland.
I know, I hate that on TV shows where it says like, oh, this family's from Leeds, and this family's from Scotland. There you go. That's it. That's where you're from. Doesn't matter where, from that point.
We had to sign forms to say like you can't talk about like being on the show. Like we had to sign NDA forms, and like they were like you can't tell anyone, you got to keep it a secret. However, when they were actually filming like that 5 minute highlight video, they have us outside on our grass shouting, "We are the Mohammed family and we're from Scotland and we're on family fortunes." What is the process that you're thinking of here?
That's
Like, we had people walking down the street who were filming us. There was a window cleaner who was across the road who kind of stopped cleaning someone's windows to just stare at us for a really long time. That was a bit uncomfortable until we moved. And then we had like messages from people being like, "Hey, like we heard that you're on Family Fortunes." I'm like, "Oh yeah, how did you hear? Yeah, you shouted it like in the estate." All right, okay, that makes sense.
I got some pictures from Pete, from some backstage ones from, I don't know if
Oh my
anyone can see
God.
that. Some nice wee backstage photos of
Yeah,
it. Pete
that
WrestleTalk Pete is very proud
was
of his time there.
There's we had to, I don't know if it was on the practice run or the actual run. Basically, like they have you like you go down to the set and they like check your microphone, they do like a practice round, but they don't get you to see the family that you're playing against because they had two different like tapings that day. And they had like they switched families around. So like one family from like the first taping was like practicing with like us and then vice versa for the other family. So we came down and I don't think we did particularly well on that one. So it was kind of foreshadowing what happened on the actual thing. But I want to say it was either that one or I think when we came down for the actual taping, we had, I don't know who sings it, but it's a song called like Black Superman and it's about Muhammad Ali. And we played that while dancing down to the set. And the other family are already like on the like waiting at the podium. And we just started dancing to our podium. And then the crew around just started getting into it as well and started dancing as well. We were just like hyping up the whole crew.
I was, oh, because of course there wouldn't be a crowd, would there? Or was
No,
there
there
still
wasn't a
a crowd?
crowd. So like what you see on like the set is essentially that's it. And then from behind, all the crew is like it's like see how you get like a storage facility? It's essentially like that. You've got like the set there, and then behind it, well, like Gino's looking down the camera and everything. It's just all the crew, and it's just dark there. You can't see anything. And then over to the side, you've got, I want to say like all the prizes and stuff, like, oh yeah, you've won this, or you could win this. They have all those just like launched to the side. And then the producers on like another area. So it was weird when like Gino would be talking to like straight down the middle at the camera and then expecting a laugh and they would just like press a button and then boom, laughter.
Oh, right. Okay. Go. Okay. See the magic of television here. We've got some questions about this though. And I'm sure I'll probably have some as well. We've got Kwaku coming in first with what was it like to meet Gino?
See, I saw this question, and I don't know if I want to break his heart. Because I love Kwaku. He is such a good announcer. But oh, Gino was a bit eccentric.
Right.
Like what you see on TV, like when we had watched Family Fortunes beforehand, we thought, oh yeah, Gino is such a nice guy, he's all that. The man swears a lot. Oh my God. Like, so especially like at the end with Judge Judy, he was like swearing there, swearing at the producers, being like, what the fuck is this? Like, are the questions right? Like, am I doing this right? And we just got told, like, leave now. Because, like, Gino was about to, like, throw a tantrum. And yeah, like, every time there would be, like, something wrong, he'd just start swearing. And then, but, like, even afterwards, like, he was chill for the most part, especially when, because I was nervous. As soon as we got to the point, I was terrified, especially when it came to like that 20-second thing. He was like, he came up and like started reassuring me there. And even like there was like the first two rounds where we got no points. He came up to us at the break and she went, guys, like, get it together. Just essentially like, come on, guys, don't be shit.
You're making me look bad here.
Genuinely, yeah. And then afterwards, yeah, like we got back to the hotel room, and we've like, so I was in a state after the show for understandable reasons. So I'm like, I think it was literally on, I think Andy had done like a FPWA call that day because it got filmed on a Thursday. I remember that because I did a Andy was doing an FPWA call, like one of the webinars. So I was literally on that right after Family Fortunes. And then like I guess like we had this WhatsApp chat with like me, Pete, and like my family. And they put in selfies that like Gino was also at the hotel and they got selfies with Gino. I was like, I've missed that. Right? Is Gino still there? Is he there? He went, nah, he's gone to his hotel room. That missed it.
I'm just imagining you guys just get all getting escorted out with a wee blanket over you as Gino is about to just erupt.
Yeah, it was essentially that. Like he was swearing at the producers, going wild, and we were just told like by one of them, just like just go, just leave now. Like
Is
we
it a
couldn't even
case?
see, like, we were like gonna wave and say bye. We're like, nope, just get out.
It a case now? Now you can watch you watch it, but I don't know if you've watched Family Fortune since your episode came out or before it. But is it one of those cases now you watch it and go and spoil the magic a little bit for you that you know that when it's not
Yeah.
happening, he's just going mental in the background?
Oh yeah, like I know, like it has spoiled the magic just in terms of like most like game shows and stuff now, where like I know what it's like backstage, and I know like not everything is real from what you see on like TV, because even in like Family Fortunes, like the episode that we did, they had to like redo a couple of stuff. So like the. Like at the start, the first question wasn't actually the first question. We had messed up the first question that bad that they had to restart the episode.
Wow.
And like, because it was like my mum, bless my mum, but she knew no answers. She didn't. So like she was on like the first on the thing. And like they asked her, I can't remember what the question was, but my mum presses the buzzer. Couldn't think of something. Like it was other person couldn't think of something. My dad couldn't think of something. The other guy couldn't think of something. And then Gino was like, nah, cut it, we're starting again. We can't have this for like the first question on the show. And there he was swearing as well.
Course, that's it. That's what seems to be the through line here that Gino swears a lot. So we've got a couple more questions about it. Of course, the obvious retro Randy Valentine asking name a famous judge on a talent show. Which I think you guys were hard done by because that was my first answer as well. And if you're stuck there for 20 seconds.
The pressure, you don't actually, I didn't realize the pressure until you're standing there and he's like firing down all these questions at you. I mean, like, to answer the question, Simon Cowell. Second of all, I hate retro Randy Valentine. Hate him with an absolute passion. Third, okay, this is I don't know if you're probably going to get a message from like Family Fortune, so I don't know what's going to happen here, but you're about to get an
Come on,
exclusive.
Gino. Come on, Gino. Come at me.
Billy Strachan versus Gino DeCampo. Let's go. So my dad also said Judge Judy for his answer on that 20-second thing, but they had redone it. Like I was saying, like the redo the answers and everything. Like I did my 20 seconds, said Judge Judy, and I'm like at the podium, just in a state, thinking, "Oh God, I've messed this up. I've messed this up." My dad gets the same questions, and he says Judge Judy, and the crew and Gino just go silent, and I just look up and go, "No way! No, like surely, like it would be fine if I did it and I messed it up." But it's weird now that my dad has said it as well.
Yeah.
And the kid realized that. So Gino had stopped. And like my dad's sort of standing there looking around, thinking that he like shot a cat or something. And like Gino just like froze down the questions, goes like, "All right, cut it. We're gonna have to do this again." Producers go up to my dad, being like, "Look, you're gonna have to redo this answer. You're gonna have to like either say Judge Judy again, or like say nothing, or just say pass." My dad, to be fair, could have probably said like an actual answer, and it, to be fair, like it would have had to be counted, but I think they were like talking to like because they have lawyers on the side as well for like legal reasons, and they're like, "Oh yeah, if it's like because obviously there's like big money involved, they have to make sure that everything's like legit." So the like, producers were talking there, being like, "What do we do? What do we do?" And there was a case of, "All right, just say pass." And my dad's still so confused that like they turn the cameras back on and go like he asked the question, and my dad just goes pass. Just oh, you had the chance, but
You're all standing there thinking, Stephen Mulhern would treat me like this.
I love Stephen Mulhern. I prefer Stephen Mulhern over Gino DeCampo.
But we'll go one more Gino question then. We'll get that one out of the way. We've got Callum asking, who wins between Bradley and Barney Walsh against Gino and Fred? So,
Oh, so who Bradley and who?
Barney Walsh is his son, apparently trying to
Ah,
into the business, nepotism, you know.
that's a second generation. I feel like I'd want to say Gino and Fred would have the advantage there, but I don't know. As Bradley seems like a fighter, he seems like he's done a bit of brawling in his time. And like the son will end up like I don't know, pull out a moonsault or something. It's just standard. He just do a moonsault.
Just bust it out there. Okay, so we're putting aside Family Fortunes now. We've done it. I think we've rinsed it as much as I possibly can. But did it give you more confidence in so since then, of course, you came back and in Fair City, especially your TV's Umar Mohammed. So you've got the clapper, you're cocky, confident. Did that kind
Lord.
of experience help with you like getting into character? You can kind of channel all that is what I'm saying is TV's
Yeah.
Umar Mohammed really Gino DeCampo?
Yes. I mean, like, I would say a bit. It definitely added more in terms of like not mileage, but also the stuff that I can do as well. Because I was already doing like coming out with like the Oscar and pretend I was like big film star. And then like once like Family Fortunes came out, it was like, okay, no, he actually is on TV. So it was a case of I can't remember who I said it to. Because like obviously there was TV's Chris Archer
Of course.
at WrestleZone. So I think I want to say I said it to like either Scotty or Aspen. I just went, like, do you think I should do like TV's Omar Mohammed? And they were like, "Yeah, do it." So then, like, I don't really do it at WrestleZone, but like for FCW, that's the full shebang, clapperboard and everything. But like even at WrestleZone, I have like the clapperboard, but like FCW, I kind of like turn up a notch. in terms of just making it more. I was on TV.
I like it. Just I like Clapperboard especially because of course you change it up every show. You're going through masking tape like no tomorrow.
So much masking tape.
Updated. I know. Get shares of masking tape at this point. I appreciate it. I saw the Instagram one where you put the one for this as well. So that quite like that. So it's a cool little thing. You can do it for, of course, you sell little clapperboards as well at your merch stand and all that kind of stuff. It's a cool thing.
I also sell these ones now for a fiver. They're like actual clapperboards.
There we go. Available at all merch stands. If you see Umar Mohammed, they'll be there. Will they be signed, personalized, or?
I do sign them. So
there we go. In their choice of colors, I'm assuming silver, gold, you know, all the colors.
Aspen was stealing my colors at Ellen, like at the merch table, and he just nicked one of my pens. He went, "Oh yeah, which color do you want?" I'm like, "Those are my pens." And he went, "Nah, not anymore."
Oh no, you share. It's pens, wrist tape. That's what I've learned that pens you share in wrestling. That's it. So you spoke about FCW. That seems like a good kind of segue. I've got a question from Daniel Micah about Fair City Wrestling. So he's got, who would be Omar's number one choice to be? I'm going to read this again. I'm not having to. This is why I probably should stop doing recordings at 12 noon, because I'm not awake. Daniel asking, who would Omar's number one choice be from the Scottish wrestling scene be? You've had too many bees there, Daniel. To bring into glory hunting agencies. I'm sure Marcus will get right on it. There we go. We got there eventually. Hashtag for the glory.
I want to say this guy, but you've hyped him up enough that I feel like he's going to end up like quote tweeting this and be like, oh, Omar's Ronan King. Yeah. Ronan King seems like the ideal pick for me for like the third member. If we were doing like Glory Hunter Agency is like a big, massive thing. Like he's 19 years old and he shouldn't be as good as he is.
It's disgusting, isn't it? It's disgusting.
Honestly, it is. He is really good. So I'd love to one wrestle him, if not wrestling him, like in a tag team with him at FCW, like with Asher and Marcus. That'd be pretty cool. They're like matching jackets.
There you go. Yeah, he could get his. He could put his mum's jacket back in the wardrobe, and he could get one specially on it.
Just the amount of stuff he has nicked from his mum's wardrobe for his entrances. I don't know why, but it works.
He's got a very interesting fashion sense. The same with, like, I don't know if you've seen Ian Skinner down in Solve Pro. He's got
the crop top.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, if you've got the abs to pull it off, fair enough. I think I would look like Winnie the Pooh if I tried it. But you know, it's a bold choice. So Ronan King, yeah, he is gonna try and clip this or quote tweet it but that's what's gonna happen. But at least hopefully I'll get some eyes on the episode and we can enrich the masses with our wondrous banter.
Oh, yeah.
So speaking of fashion, then, look at these segues everywhere. I know.
You say that it was unstructured. However, I feel like you've structured this well.
Well, I'm hoping this is episode 190, so I'm hoping at some point there's some sort of structure has come in about that I've not realized has happened. But so you're episode one, and then you're episode 30.
Right. Okay.
So, and then you cameo in episode 10, of course, with the dinosaur question. You answered that in the middle of the FPWA one with Ross Hunter.
Yeah.
And Nate Stevenson. And then you cameoed at 150 as well with the Avenue Anarchy road trip.
Avenue Anarchy. Yeah, I didn't realize how many episodes that I've been on.
So you're catching up. I mean, Scotty Swift's due to be on middle of April, so he's still going to be just ahead. But
okay,
get there. Your cameos are counted or boosted up your count. Maybe you'll be on the birthday bash. No, Bonanza.
That'd be good.
It's the birthday bonanza because Mickey Vago stole Bash when I was thinking of doing it. Anyway, fashion. That's where we're at. Kale Valhalla asking, who has looked the best in a Shirani and why is it him?
Why is it him? He does pull off a Shirani. It's a weird one because there's I don't even know how the Shivani thing started. I want to say Ted was the first one that, like, I said, okay, like, if you're, like, if you're tagging with me, do you want to be the Shivani? And then it just became, like, a thing with whoever I was tagging with wore Shivani. It's like the one that Caleb's got was like not personalized for him, but essentially like I had a Shivani, and it was massive on me. But when I found out at like the WrestleZone that was tagging with Connor and Caleb, I was thinking, okay, this can work for you because the colors match. And I just took a pair of scissors and just completely tore it to shreds. And he's like, do you think you could take the arms off as well? Yeah, you go in like sleeveless and everything. It's either him or Scotty. And I feel like, for obvious reasons, I want to say Scotty.
Mm-hmm.
But, oh.
We'll try to show a picture of it for folk that are unaware, but I've already realised that it bounces back the light quite badly. So there you go. There's
like, he pulls it off so well.
It's stupid sexy Caleb. Of course he pulls it off. That's just
like, yeah, okay, we'll go for Caleb and Shirani. He does look the best because it just fits.
I know. So speaking of that, when I tried it on when you did it, Christmas Chaos, it did not fit me at all. It was a tight fit. We needed yourself and a little bit of Martin trying to get thing off me because it was just stuck.
Was that the one that I cut into sleep? No. That was another one. There's like, I've got two white ones, so I'm not sure. There was the first white one that I had where I wore for like the GPWA show,
mm-hmm.
like way back when. And then that one got a bit tight. So then I cut the sleeves off that. And then I wore that for Ellen. The other one's like a new white one. I get them mixed up, but then that one, was that the one that, that was the one that got stuck on me on the hijinks.
So it's got a reputation now for just getting stuck on folk. That's fine. I don't feel so fat. I don't feel so fat now when I know that you also just get like, stuck on.
Going up to Dennis. Dennis, I genuinely can't take the jacket off. You're going to have to help me. And then he's like, Omar, it is stuck. Yeah, I know. Please, pull it off. Please. Oh, God. Don't clip that. No.
I can't help you there. There'll be someone will do this, and Ronan will be there trying to get rid of the memories of everyone tweeting him the quote tweet of himself saying he's not the best wrestler in the world, and he'll just be replying back with Umar Mohammed going, "Dennis, pull me off."
Oh no! All right. Well, that's that out of the way.
That's the signs of anarchy this year. That's it. Big sign. Dennis pulled me off.
Just the next time that Dennis is reffing one of my matches, just I'm sorry. just shake his hand and then like, do I need to wash it afterwards?
Sorry, well, his hands are going to hit the mat three times, so you're absolutely fine. It's terrible referee. So everyone's got had a go at the Shivani, and of course, Scotty, the red and gold number, which is perfect for him. We didn't get to see the might of all three is at Regal Rumble because somebody got COVID. So Damien got a go as well. Connor's had a go. So is there a point where it's not even a point of you going, do you want to wear one? Is it if someone finds out they're teaming with you, you go, right, what have you got for me then? What colours have you got that I can pick from?
I want to say that was Damien. I feel like Damien did that. Because right. Like when we were like, talking about it, even like Scotty as well, because I did it with Ted, and Scotty was like, no, like, I'm getting a Shivani. So we were like looking for Shivanis. Just to clip it, Shivanis are jackets for like one of these things, if no one has any idea what they are. So we were like, he wanted one that was like actually for him. So I thought, okay, we found one. And then he bought it, and I went, no, like I'll get it for you. Because obviously, like we were doing the tag, and like that thing, it was one of those matches as well, like that Summer Hill match, where like even like tagging with Scotty at that time was like for me like a huge deal, mm-hmm. like still is. Like the fact that like I literally just like turned up at Rest Zone and they're like, oh yeah, you're already tagging with like not the John Cena of Wrestle Zone. They're like, okay, this is quite cool. And then he was like, yeah, I want a Sherwani. So I thought, okay, right, okay, you're into this. That's fine. And then I was like, no, I'm gonna like I'll pay for your Sherwani. And he's like, no, like this is mine. I'm keeping it. And then like, yeah, did he? Yeah, he wore that for that Anarchy match as well. And Battle Nations, yeah. Oh, I miss going.
That Summer Hill match, though, that was wild.
Oh, yes. It ended under horrific reasons, but the actual match was a thrill.
I was just one of those where, because we were right at the where the apron was, so we didn't get to see a lot of the stuff happening at the back.
Yeah.
We could just hear it, and it was just, Jesus, it was because I work in insurance. But sadly, my grown-up brain went, "Geez, oh, they'll be looking at their public liability insurance for this. They'll be having to check this." And I'm fairly certain that's broken.
Oh yeah.
See stuff broke all about, and Jesus, that was a lot of fun to watch. I mean, not so much fun to see Dino very close up, sparky out with an elbow. You have amazing crumple physics. I don't know if it's just a natural thing, you're not doing it on purpose, but you seem to be able just to crumple
Crumple. That
when you're getting
seems to
punched.
be my thing in terms of like even Damien watching me as well. Like Damien was what did we do? We had a birthday party for Summer, like Damien's daughter. And I think I was wrestling Alan Sterling there as well. And there was like a move where he hit me where I was like ups, like selling my neck. He went, Omar, are you hurt? I went, like, no, I sold it. He went, Omar, I can't tell half the time if you're like genuinely hurt or you're like, you're fine. So like even there when it was a case of like taking the like rolling elbow, it was like don't bump it, don't bump it, crumple. So now every time that I take one of those moves, it's like crumple. I literally have no regard for my body if it comes to bumping or anything, just straight down.
Just get them all in now while you're young and able to, and then when you hit however old, I don't know how old you are. I'm
Yeah.
assuming like early 20s. But so once you hit 30, you'll be like, ah, no bumps. I'll be doing nothing. That's
Turning 22 in like 3 months. Well, this is filmed on the 26th. So yeah, 22 in 3 months.
awful. All these youngins here.
Was it? It was, I think it was Aspen. We were talking about like potential tag stuff like ages ago for like one of the things that wrestles on. And he like mentioned something about me being young. I went, no, I'm 21. I'm not young. He went, Omar, you're young. And then I remember he told me his age and he went, like, that's like Omar, you're young. So I went, no, I don't believe you. Like, send me your passport. So he like took me a picture. He sent me a picture of his passport. And then I sent him mine and he went, Omar, like that, you're young. And then also he found out that my middle name is Farouk and has now been questioning me why my actual name, like my wrestling name, is not Farouk Mohammed. Like just coming out APA style.
That's it. That's the Halloween hijinks this year. That's it. Just the always pounded ass t-shirt, jeans, socks, just the leather gloves. I mean, you've got the gloves now, so we're
The
getting there
gloves.
slowly.
Yeah. The gloves have been a topic of debate for a bunch of the WrestleZone guys. Because some of them have been like, it works, and some of them have been like, why are you wearing gloves? I'm like, oh, works.
It was the same thing when AJ Styles started doing it. When he started getting the gloves, it was like, this isn't right. This is weird.
This is weird.
And now it's just a thing. He's done it for like 10 years now. So you're like, ah,
That's him.
okay, what happens? So are you going to do the same? Are you going to get the old logo in the middle of the palm there so you can?
It'll just be my face. I do it over my face, and it's just my face again, which is like, boom, there you
That
go.
is money. And then when you're slapping people, you're like, instead of, you're not slapping people, you're headbutting them. And then
Yeah.
that's there we go. There's your idea. There's your moneymaker. And
That's merch.
You can sell them, and everyone can put your face against their. I don't know. That's getting a bit weird now. Anyway, right. So we've got Scotty Swift here with, on a scale of 1 to I don't want to be around anymore, how disappointed were you that Turbo Team didn't happen at Regal Rumble 2022?
Hold on. I want to see if it's here. Is it here? Just for obvious reasons. 2 seconds. 2 seconds. Okay, that's that. That's for Scotty Swift. I don't know if I should explain it, but yeah. It's sad. It's sad mask Omar.
And it's the Sin Cara mask, which I think represents
yeah.
it well.
Any time that I find a mask or something, or there's been photos where for some reason like backstage, but I'll just look incredibly sad. I don't know how, like, there's just random photos where I'm just like, just so depressed. So there was like a couple of times where I've seen, so like during the summer when I was back in, like Kirkcaldy, I was training at Reckless for a bit, and like they had a mask there, and I just like put it on. I don't even know whose mask it was. It was literally just some random mask. Put it on and like took like a sad pic, and then sent it to Scotty, and that was just become a thing. Where anytime like one of us finds a mask, just take a sad pic.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
I get the mask thing. I somehow, some way, I ended up buying a Spider-Man mask. That's, I think it was the Summerhill show.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I was excited for wrestling, and I ended up coming home with it. I had to hide it, really, because I get disappointed looks when I went, "What did you buy at this merch stand? Spider-Man mask?" You're 30.
Yeah.
Yeah, still Spider-Man.
I don't want to be around anymore. It's too much shit on me. Words cannot state how disappointed I am that the Turbo Team didn't happen at Regal Rumble.
So it was just you, Damien, and Scotty. That was the team that was supposed to take place.
That's the terrible team. Me, Damien, and Scotty. And I'm gonna advocate to anyone who's listening to this or watching this. There's a show called "I Think You Should Leave" with Tim Robinson on Netflix, and it's amazing. It's so funny. And one of the things in there is like that was like one of the things that me and Scotty like bonded with when it came to Redstone, is that show. And there's another one, I don't know if you've heard of it, called Auntie Donna's Big Old House of Fun.
Yeah, I've started watching Auntie Donna. Just so I can understand the gifts.
Kaboom. But yeah, like, so it just came a point where, like, me and Scotty were talking about it, about Auntie Donna. And then we found out that Damien watched it as well. So now we've got a group chat where anytime we find like a meme or something or just a reference, we'll like stick it in there. And then when it like we found out that we were tagging together for Regal Rumble, it was like, oh yeah, it's the Turbo Team. That's another part of like I Think You Should Leave. So it was just made no sense to anyone else who understands like what is the Turbo Team. But yeah. And then Scott got COVID.
Shocking.
Just on the day, like once again, like I was at the gym, and then like just seeing the message, and I think he sent a photo. He just said like Scotty sends a photo, and I thought, oh no, because usually like last year it was a case of like the day of the show, you would like send in like COVID tests, just to make sure like obviously if you're negative, you're positive. If you're like positive, then you're gonna have to like find a replacement or whatever. And like on the day, it's just like so and so sends a photo, like Scotty sends a photo. And I think that at the bottom was just like, "I'm sorry, boys." Just I don't want to see the photo because I don't want to believe it's true. But it was just positive COVID test.
It's yeah. I was standing outside the toilets in Union Square when I saw it pop up on Facebook. I was like, no, not they can't do a WrestleStone show without Sky. That's just impossible. It's impossible.
Yeah, it was cool. It was cool tagging with Damien. Like that's the thing. That was also like a pretty fun match. Like being with him, like WrestleZone Undisputed Champion, just tagging with him is also like another one of those cases where it's like, this makes no sense. Like, why am I in this position? But they were like, yes.
That's what I mean. It's also Scotty's fault then, because of that match happening. My wife's pregnant at the time, and she was going to the toilet like nobody's business, because, you know, that's just what happened. I said, you know, like, you anyway. So yeah, so she had to keep going round the ring to go to the toilet.
The feud that started between Kelly and, was it Bill?
Yeah, it was Bill. Because of Scotty, she got shouted at twice by William Starling for going to the toilet. So, you know, Scotty's fault there. So when you came up to WrestleZone, of course, then of course everyone was like, ah, it's Umar Mohammed, he's ace. Was it a case of, did you ever read our stuff or me banging on about WrestleZone and go, he's talking shit, he's talking too much about this, this isn't as good as he's making it out to be? And then when you get there and you see the crowds, you see the kind of camaraderie and everyone being so into it, we're like, damn it, he's right. Was there ever a thought at that point? See, I know I speak about wrestling a lot.
Yeah. Oh, no. No one has any idea how much you speak about wrestling. Oh, my God. No, like, see, that's the thing. There's a joke between a few of us in WrestleZone. I don't even know where I mentioned it or what. But apparently there was at one point where I said, WrestleZone are good now. And the boys were like, what do you mean? What do you mean good now? Like, Omar, what do you mean? So now it's just a case of Omar thinks WrestleZone's good now. But like, that's the thing. Like, before, because I had only, like, I turned up, like, the first wrestling show I'd been to was, like, Aberdeen Anarchy 2019. So, and then, like, came to another few shows, and that's when I saw, like, Crusher, Conor Malloy, like, the whole, like, Johnny Lyons, Scotty at WrestleZone, Christmas Chaos 2019. So, then like, that's where, like, I started watching it, and that's where I thought, like, okay, there's, like, how have I not seen this before? There's so much good stuff here. And like, even like me being like East Fife, because like I was around like that area, so I was either there or I was Glasgow. So like I hadn't seen much of WrestleZone at the time. So when I come in there, I'm being like, oh my God, there actually is. There's like good guys there. Like, why are these guys not anywhere else? And then like pandemic happened, and then when I came to WrestleZone, like seeing the guys again, and that's when like there was that switch between like, this is them there, this is them like now. Like everyone kind of turned it up a notch. And yeah, like obviously not biased in some sense because I'm there as well, but the guys you've got there, it might be like the best roster that WrestleZone have ever had.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, you got the characters, but you've also got like the guys who can act, like, who can wrestle, and the guys who are wrestling up and down the country as well. So it's not just a case of these guys are good because like bias, it's because everyone else sees them as well. Mm-hmm. Like Foundation, they're everywhere now. Like I was there for their disco show against Scotty DeHoy, and just seeing that and thinking, like, before you were, like, even like before the pandemic, like Ryan Riley and that, like we've talked about it, where like he was there, and then now he was getting butterflies in the fall of wrestling Scotty DeHoy. Mm-hmm. It's like, yeah, like because you have put in the work, because you guys are like the best trio. Caleb Valhalla. Everywhere. The man's an
Adonis.
Honestly. And then, like, you got Ronan King, Wrestle Carnival. Honestly, like, as I think, as good the guys are here because you're keeping the scene alive here. But it's also great to see them in other places as well because it just shows how good everyone is.
Exactly, yeah. So, and they're also award winners, of course. They sweeped our awards this year that nobody paid attention to, and there was no backlash at all from them. So, speaking of appearances, we have Stupid Sex and Caleb with a question, asking, how has it that you've appeared on the SWN podcast so many times, but you haven't been on the Mickey Vagle mosh pit yet?
Mosh pit isn't halal. Vagle said it right. Mosh pit isn't halal. I don't know. I've tried to get on the podcast. Just like Vagle, get me on. But I think like he was gonna get me on at one point. But like I think like I like just came to WrestleZone as he was like slowing down the mosh pit.
Right.
So like he was like, oh, I'm gonna bring it back and stuff, but it's just as thing like because it's like the COVID pandemic sort of slowing down, like not slowing down, but it's like all the restrictions are gone and everything works now taken into consideration and stuff. Vagel's like I think he said that he's like gonna try and bring the podcast back. But for me, like with the mosh pit, everyone gets drunk.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Everyone gets drunk. But I don't drink. So I need to get like slow sleep deprived to the point where I, because that's the thing. Even on like nights out with my mates, like they'd be blackout drunk. But I'd get to the point where if like I need to be like sleep deprived, like I wouldn't be feeling drunk. I'd just be feeling so tired that I'd end up acting as if I was drunk.
Right, okay.
Without actually being drunk. It's weird. I just somehow, like, I don't know. So, like, Vagle would need to do it at, like, 3 in the morning for me to say anything that what the boys say on there.
I've always considered the mosh pit just like our podcast, like, cousin. You know, the one that appears every so often but says something horrific and then leaves. And you never see them for a couple of weeks, and then they come back and they've killed a badger somewhere, and they're going, look at this, something this. Yeah. And it's just a very,
it's like in Brooklyn Nine-Nine, you've got like Jake Peralta, which is Scottish Wrestling Network, and then you've got Pimento, which is the mosh pit.
That is right. That is excellent. That is a tremendous comparison, as Vega would say. I enjoyed my time on there.
I just finished watching all. Literally just watched all seasons of Brooklyn Nine-Nine again. I think like past week there. So yeah, it's all fresh in my memory. And Pimento, what a guy.
I'm still waiting for it to go on Netflix because the E4 ones, like, they've sped it up. So I'm just waiting for it to go on to Netflix so I can actually watch it at the right speed. I just see it and it's quite nice and actually let the jokes breathe. But no, you're exactly right when it comes to the mosh pit, though. Everyone gets pissed and they say things that they possibly regret in the morning or they pass out in the case of Vagle himself. So it's an interesting time. So the key is it needs to be a gentleman's mosh pit where everyone's just drinking water and having a good time. Or would you be good at the quiz? If you do the quizzes, is the genre of music that Vagle has, would you be fine with it?
See, my music taste is very varied. Like, it's just all over the place. So, I got on Spotify, I've got, like, my Shazam connected to it. So, any song that I'll, like, I'll just, like, Shazam, I'll go straight down to this playlist. And I want to say, I don't know what's up now, I want to say it's, like, 90 hours of music just on this one playlist. Hold on, let me see. It'll tell me here. 99 hours 14 minutes of songs on this playlist because I just have such a varied music taste. So but at one point I will offend Vago and just say like the one song that he'll hate or like the one band.
Biffy Clyro.
To be honest, I've listened to a few. Like, what's it? The Captain? Is that one of them?
Yes.
Yeah. Like, I think that's one that I've listened to, but I feel like he's gonna clip this now and be like, Omar's never coming on the mosh pit now.
He likes one Biffy Clyro song, that's it. He is out. Not only can he not drink, but he likes shite as well.
But I will say, based on my track record when it comes to like entrance music, I feel like I've got good music taste.
That's fair. Oh, of course, yeah. I would like a little bit of a rock out to a bit of sensational music. It's all good. Right, let's see what else we've got here. We've still got loads of questions. It's great. Judas Grey. Are you aware of Judas Grey?
Love Judas Grey, yeah.
Oh, great. So that means I don't need to explain this to another person. He just asked, hey, you want to join my gang?
I've got both my parents, so I don't know.
There's only one. Then one of them needs to go to join.
One of them needs to go. Oh God!
I feel like I've become an advocate for DMG. I don't know how it's happened, but it seems to be I'm the only one that's promoting it out to the masses, and it's just Judas going like a Judas in the background going, "Hey, ask about DMG. Ask about it. Spread the word of DMG." I'm like going.
I don't know if it's him just genuinely asking if he wants to join the group, or he just wants to know what people's not parent life is like. I don't know. He's slightly just like subtly trying to ask it.
I'm still dreading the day. It hasn't happened yet where I ask someone this and they go, "My mum died like a week ago," and I'm like, "Oh my god.
Oh god. Oh god."
So
it's like when you're at a show, and if you're heel and like a crowd's like shouting at you and it's like, "Oh yeah, you suck," and it's like, "Oh yeah, but so did your mum," and it's like, "Oh, there's a fine line where something can happen there where someone can be like, my mum's dead."
I don't think you can come back from that if you shout that and someone just goes, my mum's dead, you
just okay,
I'm just gonna not look at you for the rest of this time.
I'm pretty sure that happened at W3L. I want to say because I think like Musawad came in at one point and he's went, "Guys, don't make any jokes about people's mums anymore." And we're like, "Oh, okay, that, yeah, okay." I think it genuinely happened at W3L.
I like that someone's had to complain, going, "Yeah, my mum just died. Don't make mum jokes."
I think that was the actual situation where, like, someone had made like a "your mum" joke, and someone complained about it. So now it's a case of, yeah, just don't make any reference. Just that thing is like, you can do so much better than your mom jokes, so don't say it.
it gets you creative, I suppose. You've got to think of something else, and you can't just go "your dad," because that would just be counterproductive, I suppose. Just in case. Right, okay. Ian Skinner asking, how long's our match been going on?
See, I keep forgetting about this match. I don't even know when the whole thing started. Was it? It might have been the Twitter polls that you were doing.
All right, okay.
I don't know if it was because of that, or he'd had a match. I generally don't know how it started, but for some reason he just like he messaged me at one point, being like, "Can you do a video where you're accepting my challenge to a match?" And I was like at FPWA, so I was like, okay, like said to like Johnny Lyons, "Can you just like film me on my phone just accepting a match?" And now it's become a thing where for some reason we're just continuously having this match. It's like the Gene Money and Session. Yeah, but they've just been having this match this whole time. But for me and Ian Skinner, there's never been a match. So at this point, I want to say it's like 3 years. This match is might be somewhere, I don't know. But yeah, this match might have been going on for like 3 years now. If we're thinking logistically about it.
Yeah, I was like, did we check back there? I was expecting, because there's a nice shadowy bit behind you that I'm expecting you just to just pop up from and
He
just
just
go.
like turns up and is like, hey, and we just have a match right here.
That seems like the most Ian Skinner thing in the world, though, that for that to happen. Speaking of shadows, segues are just ace. I'm on
Yeah,
fire.
are you aware of the power of
That
shadows?
is from Brent Carter.
Do you know, I didn't actually know that that was the question. I thought I was just making another I think you should leave reference.
That's good because I looked at that question going, it's a Yu-Gi-Oh thing? I don't know what's happening. So, yes, he has asked, are you aware of the power of shadows?
Yes.
There we go.
Yeah.
And I don't know if there's anything more to that at all, or just watch the thing.
District 9. I don't know. A copy of District 9. That's the only answer.
Cool. That's fine. Neil Malone, let's get this one out of the way. Anything good been on TV recently? So, assuming that's a reference to yourself. Or I mean, if you've got any recommendations, of course, Auntie Donna, you've frozen for a moment there. I
Yeah,
thought
I was gonna say, I was like,
that.
what happened there?
Okay. So, anything good been on TV recently? So, what's your recommendations?
Oh, this might come as a surprise, but I don't really watch a whole lot of like current TV shows. Like Scotty's just now started getting me to watch Parks and Recreation. Is it Parks? Yeah. Yeah, he's like, it's my favorite show. I was like, okay, I've just finished Brooklyn Nine-Nine. I'll give that a watch. In terms of like actual right now TV shows, the only one that I would say confidently that I've been watching is like The Apprentice. I don't know. I really enjoy The Apprentice. It's amazing seeing, because obviously it's a high pressure situation there. You got like Lord Sugar there. All the money and some of the ideas that these guys come out with is absolutely amazing.
I suppose with now you've seen the magic of TV as well, you'd be like, well, how have they done that? How have they done this as well, kind of
Yeah.
thing. And how have they made it past any vetting stage to get to this point?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like, I think one of them was from, like, they were making a drink, I think, or there was like some sort of fitness company. And they had this like wave of like water that like came down, like it was like a wave doing like what's the pose? Is it the yoga pose? I don't know. No, downward dog's the other one. It's like the one where you're like on your chest and then you push up. I can't remember what pose it is.
I'll shock you, but I don't do yoga.
Oh,
So,
I thought you did. I thought you did.
supple body does not suggest that, but.
But it's like in that, and it's all like the wave. And they made the wave for some reason brown and green, so it just looks like shit. It genuinely just looks like shit, and like they got called down on it, and they have no clue. Someone made a drink, like for kids, and it was called First Time, and it was meant to be foodies, but they had split it, so it was food dyes. And it's a great, not binge TV, but it's like you're just sitting there, you got nothing else to watch, and you see everyone just like just fail.
It just makes you feel smarter that you're like, I'm sitting here, but at least I'm not
Yeah.
looking like an absolute moron on
Like for like the film and like production nerd that I am, see like they do like challenges where they make like advertising. They got like advertise a product or whatever, and they're doing like all this acting, and they're like showing like their highlight videos, and just looking on and thinking you could do so much better than that. Like that just looks horrendous. Like I just like just get me there and let me do it because it annoys me.
Oh no. That's the thing. I mean, I am no editor by any stretch of the imagination, but when I see other podcasts or even promos, I'm looking going, no, this could have been done so much better. Why are you doing it this way? And then I sit back and go, I have not edited at all. I have done absolute jack shit with my own podcast. I'll top and tail it and put it out. That is my editing. But I'm still watching others going, well, that was a bad choice. Why are you in your car doing your promo? I don't know. Is it the acoustics? I don't understand it. Why is it portrait? Like, there's so many things that go through your head watching these things.
The one that really bothers me, and I think like when some people have been like, so like, some guy sent me like promos me like, oh, what do you think? One of them that really bothers me is like if you're doing like one highlight videos or like doing your promo, and you've got like so you got like landscape there, but then you've got so the video's there, but you've got like two black lines there. And I'm just like, that just looks just like fill up the screen. Cause it just look cause you have like somewhere it's like white screen, you can see everything, and then boom, it's like squashed and you got the black lines. That's like one of my pet peeves. I don't know, it's something about it just bothers me.
I mean, again, I don't have anything top and bottom here, so I'm not one to judge. But you can go to like Canva and just add a background. I mean, that's what I
It's
did
like
when.
just crop the video.
Yeah, because I got I got like intro videos from folk, and it was great. And I'm still shouting out for more, but they come in portrait, so I just put a background in and make it look at least better, or at least have their name or that in there. So yeah, nothing annoys me more unless it's Instagram, which I understand because that's how it's set out, or TikTok. But if it's Twitter or Facebook, don't make it portrait. It looks stupid. That's the or. Put a background like you're saying, fill the screen.
Fill the screen or don't do it in portrait, just do a landscape. You get so much more. It just looks better.
Speaking of videos, I am absolutely so happy with my segue in today. Alex Webb has a question. He's asked, have you enjoyed the cameos you've made in his videos?
Yeah, to be fair, I actually I don't know. He's put like videos there in what is that videos plural? Because I don't know. I know that I'm in one of them, but I don't know if there's any more. So I'm concerned now. I need to watch his other videos. He's got a few more out. There was so when I was like training at Reckless, I did like one of the Reckless galas, and me and Stephen Miles. I don't know, is it Stephen Miles? Air Miles? I don't know. I don't know. I don't know if there's like he goes by Stephen Miles sometimes or he goes by Air Miles. I don't know. But there's like we were tagging there, and for some reason there was these belts that Reckless had, just some random belts, and we ended up winning them. For like it was like the gala championships. And we won them. So I sent it to we won them. So I sent it to like Webb. And like I don't even know. Like I'm trying to look for the message. But you just like, why stop nicking my dad? I don't know why. You just like stop nicking my dad. And then he messaged me after when he put out his one of his videos. He went, oh yeah, have you seen my new video? There's a thing in there for you. Oh, that was what it was. I was watching one of his videos, and I'm like one of those guys where if you put on like if someone's doing a review or they're doing a video and they have like a bunch of texts that goes like straight down like really quickly and it's like meant to be a joke or it's like meant to be one of those like disclaimer forms, I always pause it and read it because I know there's going to be something funny in there. So I always pause it and just like read it all and then continue on with the video. So like Alex had done it where he had done something where he had like put a picture up and it had like a bunch of words on it and then quickly changed it to something else. And I was like, no, I'm gonna read this. And I think one of the things was, if you're reading this, your mum's gay. So I was like screenshot it and sent it and went, just like, damn you. Damn you got me. So then there he was like, okay, I've put in another one for you. Reading it all. And it was another one of those things where it's like quick blink and you miss it text. And the other like that one was Omar, stop stealing my dad. Just
That's amazing. I like Alex. Alex is these videos are amazing as well. And now he's using this little platform to try and bolster more views so folks can go back and check for the text. He's a very shrewd businessman with his trainers and his other marketplace things. still one of the most popular episodes. So hopefully, maybe now that you've found that TV's involved, Family Fortunes, we can get this episode to
just put all the tags on YouTube.
That's it. Overtake Alex Webb's holiday special.
There was, it was Christmas Chaos last year. Where like obviously it was Saints against Foundation. So Webb had come up and he brought like his YouTube plaque. And I think it just turned to him and just went, "Oh yeah, like I forgot my Family Fortunes badge. I was gonna bring it along," and he just turned to me and went, "Those are not the same thing." Just the disdain in his face and the tone, just like they're not the same. I was like, "Oh, I didn't. Sorry, my bad."
Sorry, at least you would have got the backlash that you got for charging photos.
I got told about this. That was, I asked them afterwards, like, did Kyle send you the money for taking a photo with the plaque? Just no. Kyle, send Webb the money. Okay, send it.
Ricky,
I don't think he needs the money. He's got sponsors. Like, there's no tomorrow. So, but just send him the money.
Make Alex Webb happy. I think I upset him a little bit on our episode when I told him about his thinning hair and
the male pattern baldness.
Yeah. Are you getting more muscly? Does it mean you're losing your hair? Speaking of money,
yes, nailed it.
Taylor Bryden, ask Omar if he ever got the £2 compensation he thought he was entitled to.
See, I totally forgot what this was about. So I was like, what? I'm trying to rack my head around what it was. So like during lockdown, I would be like, I'd be buying and selling wrestling figures just as a way to make money. Because like I had my job and then go on Facebook Marketplace and boom, someone's selling a bunch of wrestling figures. And I'm like, cool, I'll buy them. And there was like a few in there, like, I can't remember what one of them. There was like a few in there that like I wanted to keep just because it was like favorite wrestlers and stuff. And then the other ones I would just like sell on. And there was one where it was, I can't remember who it was. I want to say it was like a Drew McIntyre. And it didn't come with one of the parts. And I was so annoyed. I went to the guy and went, "Look, part's not there." Like, understandably, like, "Look, I'm selling this on." And he was like, "No, I'm not sending you." I was like, "Look, just send me £2. just the, like for the part." And like he was adamant that he wasn't, and we had like an argument over it. And I was like, "Look, just like it's fine. Like, okay, you don't want to send it. And like I told Bryden about it. So now when he messaged that and put that in there, I'm just like, okay, right. Now I remember now what this was.
Oh, so was it like the ones that comes with like the extra heads and all that kind of stuff, or yeah, belts?
I think it was a pair of hands. And like,
that seems fair.
I already know that William Sterling is going to see this, and he's probably going to be raging because a similar situation has happened with him. But yes, the interchangeable hands.
I don't understand wrestling figures nowadays with all that kind of stuff. It just seems like it's not built. It's not for children if they're selling little parts like that. Like back in my day, because I'm old, the Al Snow.
Back in my day.
They're bad about it at all. Al Snow got pulled from the from like,
yeah, because he had the little head,
mannequin head, and I wanted that figure so badly, but it was gone by the time I got a Harker Holly instead, which, you know, I liked it, but it's not Al Snow with a mannequin head. But nowadays it's like all these tiny little parts that come with wrestling figures. Who is that for? Because it's not for children. It's for collectors.
It's for collectors, and there's like there's a ton of like action figure photography now. Like that seems to be like a huge thing, especially like the recent years, especially with like lockdown and everything. People just going wild, like stop motions and photography. So like they've now got like effects. So like there's one that I saw where it's like Goldberg, but he has like a smoke. You like attach the smoke to him. So when he's like doing his entrance and he like blows out the smoke, it looks like they didn't do it right, so it just looks weird. But it's just like the thought that is there, just for the sake of like people who's wanting like take photos of them. Just like, okay, weird, but sure.
I'll still stick with my hope. Like, I think I've got a Drew in the box up there, up in the where all my crap is with all my DVDs that I can't put out because the company is an absolute shite hole. But like can't put the DVDs out because you know.
I know, is it, I think it was Scotty. Scotty's done it pretty good where like he's got a wrestling figure of every guy, like every like former WWE superstar or whatever has been to WrestleZone.
That's
And I
quite
think he's got like a WrestleZone like customized ring that he got gifted. So he's like he's put every like wrestler in there. I'm like, okay, that's pretty cool. Like it's something different.
I might ask about. I'm interested to see if he's got like if because of course afterwards you got like Nikki Cross now has got a figure, Piper Niven's got a figure. I wonder if he's kind of kept it up so because they've been there, he's got a figure of them as well. That'd be quite interesting. I will write that down and then absolutely forget that I've asked that to ask about. So last kind of question is wrestling related. We've got one more that I want to finish on from Callum, but Ryan Riley has asked. I love Ryan asking questions because he always is so polite asking these
Supply.
questions. Hi Billy, hope you're well. Which is how I start every email at work, which now I see quite irritating. Could you please ask Omar why his head is so hard and ask him if he knows why my thumb is still sore? Thanks.
Cheers, Coach. It's Coach Riley. The like my head's not as hard now as since Christmas Chaos, where it's like I don't know if there's still a gap there or something, where I got like headbutted by Archer. But we were doing the it was the six man at like the training show, like. Me, Connor, and Caleb and the Shirani, against I think Ryan, Dynamite, and Ronan. Doing a spot, and I think either Coach had threw a line, and I didn't duck enough, so I like essentially headbutted his thumb, and like even now for some reason, Coach will come up to me and he'll be like, Omar, my thumb's still sore. Like, how is it still sore? It's been what, like 5 months? It's still sore. I'm like, I don't know. I don't know.
Well, I'm not a doctor.
I can't explain how it happened. But I can't, like that's like I can explain it, but I just don't know how. It's still the thumb is still sore.
So are you just saying in a very, very roundabout way, Ryan Riley's been a bit of a bitch about
Yes.
it?
Co co coaches being a bitch.
Oh God.
I feel like I should explain the thing about coach, but I don't know.
Was checking when so March 3rd is coming out. That's fine. He'll forget about me calling him a bitch by the time the Regal Rumble comes around, I'm sure.
It's all good. It's all good.
Yeah, that's fine. I'll be second row. I'll use Kyle as a shield.
Just absolutely throwing potatoes at each other based on this.
That's it. So I'll be watching it going, yes. And then see him look at me go, no,
No.
nothing happened.
You started this.
That's it. That's it. My unbiased reporting is causing frictions in WrestleZone now. That's absolutely the last thing I want. We spoke about wrestling a lot. Let's speak about Fear City for a second, at the very least. Because you're of course Grant Zay, up here you're the Asian sensation. Everyone loves you. You're in Fear City. Nobody likes you, as part of well, of course, Smashing Asher and Marcus Hunter like you, but you're part of Glory Hunting Agency. So, how's it feel like being able to do kind of both sides of the same coin, being a good guy up here, but then being able to unleash properly TV's Omar Mohammed in Fear City.
It's good experience, I will say. Like it is pretty fun to do both sides of the coin, because obviously the stuff that I can do FCW, can't do it. WrestleZone, stuff I can do at WrestleZone, can't do it. FCW. But it's just like I see like guys who work heel and face, and they do, like, they have like totally different gimmicks, characters, depending on what they are. Whereas for me, I just kind of like, I'm essentially just like the same person. I just subtly change it, mm-hmm. where I'm just more of a dick at FCW. But yeah, no, like it's been fun. Like some of the stuff that we've done, like the water bottle. Genuinely don't know about how that's transpired, but I will confirm at this moment there is only water in the water bottle.
At this moment.
Like it was like at the Rio Rumble. Not the Regal Rumble. Regal Rumble's next one. The Fair City Rumble. And like I came out with like the water bottle, and Aspen afterwards was like, why is everyone dying off your water bottle? Like why is everyone like dying off it? I'm like, I don't know. It's just water. There's essentially just meant to be water in there. However, at some point, I'm going to change it up. I may already have, and someone like probably going to be listening to this being like, yeah, he did it to me. Just a subtle prank. We're like, boom, psych, got you.
There you go, vinegar. There you go. Get a bit of vinegar in your eyes.
That's reserved specifically for Retro Randy Valentine. Based on his question.
So, well, we did get another one from Lucha DS, which was just... a family fortunes board, which I cannot find at this time, that just said, name an occupation where people try to avoid you was the family fortunes board. So I don't know if there is any. I don't have the answers, so I can't tell you if you're right or wrong. But I suppose wrestler, unfortunately, is the other one. Everyone tries to get near you.
Yeah, everyone tries to get near you.
Yeah, they're trying to add you on your personal Facebook and whatnot and creep you out. and try to find out. I like Jonathan, but is it annoying or that's your real name? So he knows your real name? I don't know if you've met Jonathan, but he knows everyone's real name in WrestleZone, if you don't know.
Yeah, I don't think he's actually added me on my Facebook, mostly because like I think I've got it like private anyway, so like even if he like scrolls through my Facebook, all he's just gonna see is me with a picture of Lightning McQueen. Like that's essentially it. So standard for what I do in actual wrestling. So like he's approached me a couple of times at shows, but I think he's been fine with me.
He's lovely. He's
lovely. He's
absolutely lovely. He wouldn't see harm to you. It might see harm to Chris Archer now, because he was furious after Station Hotel showdown. That was incredible to watch. after Archer punched Vago in the face, that was just, oh my god. I thought, everyone check where Geddes is. Check where he is. Just make sure. And I was able to see some of the footage from Ellen, and when Archer came out, it was amazing because Jonathan was nowhere near it. But with Vago, out, fist bump, he was there straight away. I was like, this is the best thing about wrestling, is watching that kind of interaction and believability in everything that happens.
I want to say it was Station Hotel, where I think, was Jonathan like right next to the entrance?
Yes, he was.
And like I came out from my entrance, and I'm like staring down at Tucker and Dawkins, and like in the corner of my eye, I see Jonathan, and like, he's got his hand up for a high five, so I like go for a high five without looking, thinking I'm gonna hit him, and it just like whiffs. So then I'm like still like looking down, being like, oh god, oh god, oh god, and then I can see him like going for a fist bump, so I'm like, boom, made the connection, and then just went straight away.
It's like, I'm not doing a third one. But that's the kind of thing you get up in a wrestling, Bear City and WrestleZone, the people just, they're there for it. They're there for every moment. Yeah. And you had the thing, of course, at Station Hotel with Scotty afterwards, who had a wonderful t-shirt. Absolutely wonderful.
Surprisingly on sale at Ellen, so I don't know if he turned up.
That explains why, because I again watched the Ellen stuff back. I saw Jonathan had one. I was like, when did these go on sale?
I don't know if Scotty turned up and like just put them up and left. I don't know. They were there.
Oh, I know. I'm buying every go rumble.
But yeah, even like Fair City, especially when like the Family Fortunes like episode came out, it was like put on like Facebook and stuff. Oh yeah, like Family Fortunes. I didn't realize that how many people were going to be watching it until I made my entrance there for the, I think, who was I wrestling? Spike Tune, I think Spike Tune and Watchco. And like people were making like the sounds and some like going nuts about like me being on Family Fortunes. I'm thinking, okay, so you have seen it. And also, I hate you all for making me relive this.
And here we are. We spoke about it for 20 minutes and said I'd put it to the side. We're back speaking about it again. So, never ended. Right, before I get the last question from Colm, because I realize this is going to be a long episode, I want you to explain this photo that I got from Pete.
Oh my god!
So for those that are unaware who are on the audio version, I am holding up a picture of Rob Van Dam with Umar Mohammed's Sensational Anarchy flag, along with I've also about to show the signed photo as well, that he got from Rob Van Dam.
Yeah.
What's the story about that?
RVD appreciates the sensational scenes. I think, RVD was at Comic-Con last year. And, like, my uncle's got one of the flags as well. So, like, he got me the one that I had for Anarchy. And then, like, he got one for himself. For, I'm guessing for this particular reason or just for, like, any reason to be at a show and just be like, boom, flag. Mm-hmm. So he turned up and like my uncle was there as well, went to the disco and like got them to take photos with the flag and then just kept like sending me photos. It's just like Caleb and I think who else was there? Caleb and Aspen just holding the flag, looking so disgusted. Just oh god. And then the other one was just like, boom, it's RVD holding my flag. Which was one weird, but also pretty cool in a sense as well. And then like my uncle got me like the signed photo. So like it's like in my house in Fife. But it was like when he sent the photo, just thinking, okay, this is real, but also, why would you do that?
I've only met Pete once. I met him at Station Hotel. I just love that he has no fear. He's just like,
honestly, he's got no fear. Whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, I don't know.
I mean, last time we did this, of course, he sent a picture of you with Wolfgang. So he's quite happy just to show off his nephew going look, which is nice. Wait. Really nice.
There was I don't know if I said it last time on the podcast, but like when I was at FPWA, Wolfgang was like doing a seminar there. And it was actually after the podcast had came out as well.
Oh, did I put the clip out as well?
You put the clip out. And like shaking Wolfgang's hand and being like, hi, I'm Omar. And there was a moment there where he kind of like paused. And like he was like, didn't want to say like he recognized me, but it was like a look of, I think I've seen you from somewhere, but I don't know where. Because that was like the first time I'd seen him since that photo. And then when you had put the podcast out again, I think like he had messaged underneath with like a reply or something. So I messaged him and went, oh yeah, hey, just like talking about the photo. He was like, yeah, I did recognize that FPWA. Like, I knew I'd seen you from somewhere, but I didn't know where until now.
Oh, amazing. Bringing wrestlers closer together for some reason or another. Right, I've noticed I've taken up a load of your time. So we're going to finish up with Callum's question, which is, how does one become sensational?
Oh. Pray five times a day. Do fasting. I don't know. Get a sherwani. Get a sherwani. Style your hair. Just be a good person. You know, that's all I'll say. Just be a good person. You know, that's how you be sensational.
Caleb, if you're not wearing a sherwani at Regal Rumble, I will be disappointed in you. That's, I'm just saying that now. That's
I've
it.
not I've been trying to, but I've been seeing about getting like how like everyone comes out and like they set for like merch. They have t-shirts. I want to try and get like sherwanis and sell them as merch. I don't know how it's if it's possible, but it's something that I'm like that I want to try and get, see if I can get that done.
So the dream is to come out for your match and everyone's wearing a sherwani and they're just going nuts
Yeah,
for
so like Mania 25, where like Cena comes out and it's just a bunch of Cenas just doing the pose. Just everyone else is just wearing Chobanis for me.
So I don't know if it's a spoiler for your Abri Anarchy entrance for this year, but
Oh no,
I
apparently no. I know I said that was my Regal Rumble entrance with the tapping. Where it's like everyone taps and it's just like Blue Thunder and Martin Clunas were like, yeah, like I like tapping. And it's just tap dancing. Just okay.
That's it. I mean, you bingo balance. He's Irish. He can make it a thing. We didn't even speak about the name of the big Kachowski for your submission move, which
Big
a little bit of a
Kachowski.
brainstorm, a little bit of a brainstorm session that we had a little bit for it. Although I just suggested loads of names, and you went, none of those. I'm picking this one instead. So.
There was a few under consideration, some of them more appropriate than others, that I can't say because my granddad loves watching my matches and just he'll probably be like listening to this or watching this. And I feel like he'll just message me be going, like, why'd you mention that? So some of them are great that me and WrestleTalk Mohammed have came up with. That would be great, but Big Kachowski is the name of the submission.
Excellent. Right, so that's it. I think that's a nice way to round up. I don't know. Can I ask you what would the fight two sheep one cow? I don't know. Does that seem appropriate at this stage?
Which
Yeah,
one?
what would the fight two sheep or one cow?
Oh. I mean, the sheep can do like tag team moves, I guess.
Yeah, I've got that.
You do like put them in the wrist lock and the other guy does a moonsault on the arm or
Do the
like on
moonsault.
the hoof, I guess. I don't know what is that. I don't know cow the anatomy of a cow really.
We'll
What
anyway, right. So where can people find you next?
if the cow's halal, then that is a different question, but you know.
Well, I mean, it's your rules from that point. That's the question. Two sheep versus one cow. That I don't make anything rules
Dep
after
depends on actually no, yeah, it depends on which one's halal.
that. Okay, there we go. That's the way we're gonna answer that question. That's it though. We're done. We'll wrap up there. Where can people find out more about TV's Omar Mohammed?
On Twitter, still the same name. I should change it. I don't know. On Twitter at sensation underscore CTP, Instagram professor of Islamonomics,
Amazing,
and
still
I'm pretty
amazing.
sure on Facebook. Yeah, Facebook, the Asian sensation Umar Mohammed. So,
Wonderful.
yeah, I've got like YouTube as well. So if you just type in the Asian sensation Umar Mohammed, it's pretty cool. Like if you type in now Umar Mohammed. Because there's so many Omar Mohammeds. If you type in that Omar Mohammed, like I come up first, so like I've claimed it. I've claimed the YouTube section of Omar Mohammed.
And Google as well. Well, I mean, I well, I Google you a lot, but you are my top two things: Instagram and Twitter for Omar Mohammed. There we go.
Take
But
that.
great. Well, thank you very much for joining me for your third appearance. I'm amazed that we kind of, like I say, had some structure in this episode, even though I
So many
promised it
segues, so
wouldn't.
many
I
good
know.
segues.
Oh, so great. It's almost like I'm a professional at this point. But no, that's it. Thank you for joining me.
Okay, thank you.